The Academy has been concerned about the pursuit of scientific knowledge since its founding, and today the Academy's initiative on science, engineering, and technology, which Gerald mentioned, led by a team that I chair with Chuck Vest, is the framework at the Academy for several Academy projects in science and technology policy area. Recent Academy projects have examined scientific literacy, the treatment of scientific topics in university curricula, and public concerns over the introduction of new technologies, such things as the internet and personalized medicine and alternative energy. Some of the Academy's work in these areas is described in the summer 2012 edition of the Academy's journal, Daedalus, Science in the 21st Century, which was edited by Jerry Meinwald, whom you just heard from, and May Barenboim. Other recent related publications include the fall 2011 Daedalus, Protecting the Internet as a Public Commons, edited by David Clark of MIT, and the policy report Beyond Technology, Strengthening Energy Policy Through Social Science, which you'll hear about in just a moment. So let me conclude with a word about why we believe the American Academy is well-suited, you might even argue uniquely suited, to take on science policy work. As a nonpartisan institution, the Academy's independence gives it the latitude to take on some issues that some other organizations might find more difficult to pursue. The Academy brings together experts from virtually all scientific disciplines, as well as leaders from industry, from public affairs, and other domains to undertake cross-sector, cross-disciplinary studies of the most pressing science technology concerns of the day. The Academy provides a special place to develop new solutions and to write credible reports that are highly regarded across the political spectrum. Now, the next part of our program features several fellows who are leading current activity projects, just to give you a flavor of what's going on here. So I invite our first panel, you know who you are, to come forward and take your places at the seat. Keith Yamamoto, Venki Narayanamurti, and Bob Fry. In 2008, the Academy published the first ARISE report, A-R-I-S-E. It stands for Advancing Research in Science and Engineering. The first ARISE study, which was chaired by Nobel laureate Tom Cech, focused on two primary issues: support for early career investigators and faculty, and support for high-risk, high-reward research, sometimes called transformational research. The second ARISE study is focusing on the need for research policies that encourage true interdisciplinary collaborations and create structures to allow those collaborations to flourish. The project is led by Keith Yamamoto and Venki Narayanamurti. Keith is Vice Chancellor of Research and Executive Vice Dean in the School of Medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, and Venki is a Professor of Physics and Director of Science, Technology, and Public Policy Program at the Harvard Kennedy School. They're working with a Blue Ribbon panel of experts from across the nation.
Well, let me tell you a little bit about ARISE. Neil has introduced it well, Advancing Research in Science and Engineering. This slide just reprises for you the topic and the committee that undertook the ARISE 1 study, and in a sense really drives home the point that Neil made about the special or unique feature of the Academy in undertaking policy studies. It's a tremendous convening power. Many of you will know some of the names on this distinguished committee list. Tom Cech, the chairman. Multidisciplinarity, being able to draw ideas from multiple directions at the same time, and independence that gives it the kind of credibility that permits these studies to have the kind of impact that Academy studies have traditionally had. So this was ARISE 1, and you can see that, as Neil said, it was highly focused. The committee chose to really drill down, get down on the ground level, the lab level, of a couple of issues. ARISE 2, in contrast, as Neil said, is much broader based. It's a big committee. Some would say that it is exactly the opposite of being down on the ground lab level. Some would say it's, you know, 30,000 foot level. Some would probably say that it's in orbit. So we hope that if it's going to be this kind of broad view, if is in orbit, it'll at least have impact. So how did the committee begin its work, and where's at this kind of scope and scale, what could it be saying? And as you'll hear from Venki, this is very much a work in progress. The committee is still doing its work. We've drafted a report, and we think we're well along with it. So we're anticipating that it will be out at the beginning of the year. Well, let me begin with this. I frame it as a question, but I think it is one of the kind of starting points for the committee's work, and this is this notion that research is at an inflection point. And by that, what I mean is that we've enjoyed a tremendous upsurge in discovery and knowledge and understanding that has come from really high-level, high-precision specialization, from defining and really drilling down on coherent problems that can be attacked and answered. But I would argue that we're actually in a phase now where there's an opportunity ahead that you can see on the horizon, but that we need to get through this inflection point to do it. And that if we can move into this area where, in fact, there'll be a much more all-hands approaches, many different strategies, experimental ideas, theories, concepts, and approaches being brought to bear on problems that are of huge scale, things that are not only of scientific significance, but of social significance. And so the question then is, if that's really true, and we have this inflection point, the committee thought this is the time to be reassessing and re-evaluating and revising the practices of the way that science is done, and as well as the policies that govern it. And in thinking about that, the committee came to a realization in carving up scientific investigation into two big sectors, physical sciences and life sciences, attaching a kind of stand-in for the application of those concepts and approaches to each, so engineering standing in for the applications of the physical sciences principles, medicine standing in for the applications of life sciences principles, we discovered that there have been distinct historical set points that have governed the cultures of those two big branches that have to be considered in thinking about how to reassess and change policies and practices. That in physical sciences and engineering that we dub PSE, I think you may use these terms, there's always been a continuum of discovery and application. And in contrast, in the life sciences and medicine, or LSM, there's actually been a disconnect between discovery and application. Nevertheless, there have been common drivers of change. These are apparently conflicting common drivers, but they're common drivers nevertheless. That scientific progress is illuminating new opportunities, and this is dependent on communication and cooperation, and that political and economic forces are driving both to be thinking about how to undertake change, and you hear this from Venki. So there are two big recommendations, and Venki's going to stand up and tell you a little bit, drill down a little bit into the details of them. I hope that you'll recognize that they call for integration of practices and policies across two sort of orthogonal planes. One is transdisciplinary science merging the physical and life sciences theory, concept, and application. And the other is stakeholder synergy, the groups that are actually engaged in undertaking, driving, or governing the work in industry, government, and academia, and the call for new recognition of the need for an opportunity for cooperation and actual synergy across those sectors, and that changes need to be made in both of these and integrating planes in order to be able to accomplish the goals that we're undertaking. So let me hand it over to Venk, and he can tell you a little bit about more about the details of the recommendations.
Thank you very much, Keith. I think Keith has set the stage. I think I just want to emphasize a couple of additional points. One is there are very strong inflection points. In the last few years, in the physical sciences and engineering, many of the great industrial laboratories, which are major supporters of physical sciences and engineering, have declined tremendously because of a variety of forces. And the life sciences, too, that have been significant, and of course, increasing issue of integration of life sciences with medicine. In the physical sciences, for certain subfields, especially condensed matter and materials physics, the relationships with engineering and industry was much more common. And so I think, how can one use some of those things to actually leverage each other's portfolios and go to a new paradigm? Because we know in life sciences and in physical sciences, there are enormous amount of opportunities where, in fact, computation, for example, has become a very integrated thing in biology, as is the tools of applied physics and engineering. And reversely, we are beginning to do many aspects of engineering because of learning from the life sciences. So there's mutual gain to be had. So I think the recommendation one, the overarching one, was to really work aim at a deep conceptual and functional integration across the disciplines. Keith, we have decided that transdisciplinary is a good word to describe this, goes beyond even, in fact, it is, but I think it's really the deeper. There are many good examples. We had many workshops, etc. Many universities, of course, have centers, etc. But nevertheless, we still often go back, you know, like a stretch spring, go back to its resting place into our individual silos. This is an issue. And that means that our academia has to transform itself in terms of many of its policies, promotions, how the structure of the academy is, etc. And we have various suggestions. It's obviously very complex. That's one. Second, there's plenty of room. In the material science field, which I come from, shared facilities are a very common thing. But really, between life sciences and the physical sciences, only now are we beginning to have the kind of shared facilities which are very important for that kind of work. And furthermore, unlike in industry, in universities where these facilities are to be placed, many of the staff which actually are key in these facilities are not able to function in an academic environment the way they should be. So there are whole issues connected with that. Then there are issues which we have discussed and we are still working on, is to address the sustainability of the research enterprise. As we know, for example, the NIH budget, which is very good, grew, but there are issues with the way, in fact, certain life sciences areas have grown, but that has also impacted physical sciences. And there are budgetary issues in the federal government, which we'll come back to, which even prevent in the physical sciences the way DOE operates and where the National Science Foundation operates. So the second major recommendation which we want is actually affects all three sectors. If in fact this issue of translation medicine or the coupling between physical sciences, engineering, and industry is really important, and industrial labs have declined significantly, there clearly is a need for new models of engagement of all of three sectors. Shubhra already mentioned, it came out from our report. We sent our first draft to the whole committee. The committee is not a shy committee. Keith and I received enormous number of comments, and we are still working on the next draft. But one of the things which came out was the international aspect, which is extremely important. The U.S. science and engineering enterprise, especially engineering, has depended markedly on manpower from abroad, on people who came the best. I came myself, and Shubhra came, and there are many other examples. And somehow, we have to do much more in the public policy point of view, in the government, into actually both for industry and for that aspect is declining. We want to have new models for academic industry research alliances. The committee reviewed several good examples which are happening, but it still is not quite endemic in the system. How technology transfer offices operate is another important area where their key function should be to facilitate the knowledge exchange, where intellectual property and licensing become far more important than need be in some cases. So that's another area. Finally, one other piece we came to, we thought We must increase the coordination and cooperation among government agencies. I already mentioned the issue of NIH and then also even DOE and NSF. For example, we might want to have a National Science and Technology Council establish a coordinating committee to focus on PSE-LSM interagency coordination. We also encourage it to set aside parts of their budget for jointly funded projects between NIH, NSF, DOE, and NASA. And finally, because of the great industrial labs and even in biology where we had some wonderful examples of solving through grand challenge problems, we might want to highlight some grand challenge problems. Many societies have articulated this, which might serve to bring these different communities together.
Thank you, Venky.